So we're going to go ahead and get started. It's now 6:01. So it's October 4th, 2018, work session Thursday. And at the top of our meeting, we have a distinguished guest, the superintendent of the Newburgh and Large City School District, Dr. Roberto Padilla. So let's welcome Dr. Padilla. He has a special presentation for us.
If you may, you can sit here at this edge right over here, and then Mr. Crosscoff, if you could join him right there, then that would be a better setup, and that way both of you can speak.
Yay.
Thank you.
Thank you. So again, we want to be brief in our remarks and get right to why we're here, and hopefully have more opportunities in the future to come and speak to all of you and to the public. And so just on behalf of the school district, we want to say thank you for all of your efforts and your stewardship of this great city. John and I are here because we want to share some exciting news with you, but we also want to conclude by asking you to consider partnering with us to do some very important work. And again, we'd love to come back throughout the school year and share additional exciting news with you to just kind of give you an update as to what we're doing and how we might garner your support in some future endeavors. So for the PowerPoint, is there a way to?
Yeah, if you have a flash.
We had that email, we emailed it to.
Oh, you emailed it to us?
To Eliana, but I don't know
if Eliana or Naomi has uploaded.
It might be already in the PowerPoint.
It, if not, it's online. We could call it right up.
I got it.
Oh, there it is. Well, that's our agenda.
That's the agenda.
You have a flash drive?
I have it online if you'd like me to call it right up. Would that work?
Yeah, come on up.
No, he doesn't have a flash drive. He's going to do it through the internet. Oh. Unless you already see the...
Speaking of technology.
And we're here to talk about technology. How's everyone doing today?
Great, man.
You all look beautiful. I hope you're happy and healthy.
Yes.
There's a lot going on in the school district. We had a really good opening, uneventful, and so in our field, that's good.
Yes.
And so we're here specifically to share with you some information around some very big technology initiatives. And so over the past 2 years, John and the team have done some remarkable work that we're not sure everyone is aware of. I need to preface that while we'll be talking about devices and such, devices are simply a tool to help accelerate teaching and learning. And so we've invested several million dollars into our infrastructure to allow the capability for teachers and students to be able to engage in more interactive learning, right? So I can recall, as much as I love my teachers, I wasn't always engaged. The style of teaching was very lecture-based, and that's not the way our students are asking to be engaged today, and it's really not the way our students learn today. And so there's a plethora of research that clearly indicates that today's learner needs to be intellectually engaged, emotionally engaged, and have opportunities to move around, and more importantly, have opportunities to collaborate. So it's not a matter of sitting quietly at a desk and listening to the teacher, but it's an opportunity to respond to a critical question and have the opportunity to think about how to address the question in collaboration with other students. So we're in the midst of a digital convergence. Mm-hmm. Our learners today today will experience the worst technology of their lives. And it happens to be the best technology of our lives. So I don't know how you feel about that statement, but it's very true, and gives us a lot of hope of what technology will look like in the future, albeit a bit scary because it's technology we've yet to consider. So John has the PowerPoint up, and simply what we want to do is just give you a status update. So John, if you want to click to the next slide.
Thank you, Dr. Padilla. So just briefly, if you think of the rapid change over the last 15 or 20 years, things started to change, the internet came along, but it's escalated at a very quick pace. So what used to be all these items on a desk, none of them exist anymore. Well, I should say most of those don't exist in most places anymore, yet very often we ask our scholars to use some of those tools. So our goal is really to provide them with today's tools so they can learn in ways and create information and share information and really be engaged in their learning. As Dr. Padilla said, the days of sitting and listening to someone who's the expert in the age when you could go to your phone and find facts, those days are gone. So briefly what we've done, the district has spent significant money on interactive displays as well as the professional development that goes along with using it effectively. So those are in almost all of our classrooms. We have the final set being installed next month. We've created a very robust network so that when we go to use a device, it works. And our speed, we've got significantly high-speed internet. We just cut over to a new carrier. The first few days were rocky, and I'm glad to say today we're up to full speed, which means when 30 students in a classroom light up their Chromebooks, they're all on with robust internet access, so they're not playing the wait-and-see game. And that takes us to the devices. Dr. Padilla said it's not about the devices, and I agree, but these devices, these Chromebooks, all our scholars in grades 3 through 10 now have access to a device. They'll start to go home with the older students as the demand is created, which gives us great potential because it breaks down that 7:30 in the morning class, right? If you're not ready to learn at 7:30 and you're more of an 11:30 p.m. person, the Yankees win and then you're on to the next thing, that's when they can learn, that's when they can collaborate, that's when they can create. So we have the tools for them, we have the professional development, we have 10, we're very fortunate, we have 10 instructional technology facilitators who are all Google certified, level 1 and level 2, so they know how to use the tools, they know what it means to transform student learning. And if you'll notice, I didn't come with a jump drive. The jump drives are fortunately, today, they're not necessary when we're all wired. So students, just as I called this presentation up, it's out there in our private space in the cloud, but students have that same opportunity. They can work from there. I could present this from my phone, just as some students choose to. But really, the opportunity to not just consume information from the internet, but to synthesize that information, to create new information, to collaborate with others, that's where we are now. And that's where our professional development is. We're looking at not replicating substituting the notebook for a Chromebook or writing. We really want to redefine what it means to be a student in the Newburgh schools. So that brings us to the point of equity. We have everything we need in the school, but we have 40 minute periods. And that's where a lot of the learning takes place, but a lot of it takes place outside of the classroom. It's that investigation. We know that students who go to homes where they have the internet and they have digital resources, they may spend hours exploring and being led down one path to another, exploring certain functions. But we also know, and I put a quote up there, which I'll just read it to you, it looks a little small on that screen. Access to reliable, robust internet service and computers are increasingly essential for learning and participation in modern society and should not be a luxury reserved for the affluent. Innovative school and district leaders are rising above fiscal constraints to ensure students have broadband access both during and beyond the school day. So if a student goes home with a Chromebook, and as I just connected here, if they can't connect, they're limited. And that's a real opportunity divide. So there are some plans, there are plans where you could buy you can connect to a small cellular device, but these are spot solutions to a broader challenge. And the challenge is, how do we make sure that each and every one of our scholars has the opportunity to connect with the world that they're inheriting, right? So it may look like the hotspots that are available, cable companies, you know, you look at your phone or your computer and you see they have sign in. And if you're fortunate to have $50 or $100 a month cable service, you can log in and use the service. So some of the, looking at partnerships, you know, are there partnerships where we're able to really leverage the power of the city and the school district? And, you know, if there are charters doing business in our community, maybe there's something to give back. The infrastructure's already there. We've invested heavily in the devices and equally as heavily in the professional development that's sustained and ongoing. But when you look, I just pulled one of those photos up from the students from last year. When you look at those students, you wonder which ones are going to go home and be stuck and not have it till they come home, or they're going to have to go to you know, McDonald's and sit there because there's free Wi-Fi. That's not the same thing. And so this issue of digital equity is a big deal. And with that in mind, I'll cut my comments and hand it back to Dr. Padilla. But just think about what that desk looks like and what our students are going home to. If it doesn't look like today's workplace, they're going to be challenged when they enter it. So thank you for your time. I appreciate that.
So I'll just add that clearly you understand that today's economic environment is global. So our kids are competing with kids from other countries. And when we think of the city of Newburgh, knowing everything John just mentioned around, we have interactive boards in every classroom, we increase how robust our network is, so that way when every classroom goes on, they're not getting kicked off. So it has the capability to handle that many users at once. We have every third through 10th grader has his or own device. Teachers have their own device now. 11th and 12th graders have a bring your own device initiative, but we have carts available to those students who don't have a device to bring from home. And then we have carts for K1 and 2. So we're pretty much K through 12, approximately 12,000 students have their own device. Our challenge is, when will they be allowed to bring them home? And when they go home with those devices, will they be able to use the devices to access this learning? And I think this is where we can leverage our partnership. How could we work together to either seek out grants or go to our providers to say, we want all of our residents to have access at home? Now, I know that I don't want to make that sound easy, because it's not. There are a number of communities across the U.S. that are providing internet access in every single household. They're doing it a number of different ways. So whether it's in the home directly, which is the best case scenario, or worst case scenario, it's remotely in various spots of the community. So that way, individuals who live in those communities have access from something outside, like a pole or, you know, Starbucks or what have you. There's a number of ways we can come together and try to solve the digital equity challenge. We don't have the answers, we have ideas, we're studying other communities, but it goes beyond just a school district. It's really a school district and a local government coming together to find ways to provide that level of access. And with that, I conclude by saying thank you and ask you to please consider how might we be able to come together to provide that level of access. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Padilla.
Thank you.
Before you go, just really quickly, to John and Dr. Padilla, we've had some conversation with one another about this, and I'm really excited. I've had some dialogue with the city council and some of the other partners in our community regarding creating a technology hub. And in fact, about 6 months ago, I met with a woman who is continuously in dialogue with me, who has a PhD in computer science, and she is very much willing to help as well. But the vision that I have, and that is a shared vision with the school district, and if not all, on the council, is creating a technology center somewhere in our downtown area where we can not only provide some of that Wi-Fi capability and decrease the digital divide, as you were speaking about, with people or families or students that don't have access to Wi-Fi in their homes. In addition to, like I said, creating this hub, this technology hub, where people can come to the technology tower or center in our downtown area, have access. There should be seminar rooms where we can, students or young people or even adults can get training on cybersecurity, networking, how to read code, whatever, to what extent or what level they want to engage in technology, to learn. And so I know we're committed, and what I would like to do is take a very aggressive approach to this and ask some of my colleagues on the city council, we're going to form a committee, a technology committee, to aggressively work in collaboration with the Newburgh and Large City School District so that we can identify that grant funding and identify what we need to do financially to make this a reality sooner than later. The other point is, I've been around the city of Newburgh long enough and been engaged with the community long enough to remember, and I mentioned this to Dr. Padilla, Michelle, when Verizon was coming into the city of Newburgh around 2006, 2007, the Art and Culture Commission then, which I was a member of, was asked to go through some of the documents and some of the agreements, the licensing agreements between Verizon and the city, and make recommendations. And there were recommendations that were formed from the Art and Cultural Commission to allow Verizon into the city of Newburgh with some givebacks, okay? And those, when they were coming in, laying down the fiber optics in the city of Newburgh, they came and we recommended to the city council that there be two, if not three, public access television, free public access television networks for the city and the city residents to have access to, but also some sort of give back to the community regarding Wi-Fi, and they were coming in. So a lot of those things didn't come to full circle or to full fruition, and there may be an opportunity between the city government, the Newburgh and Large City School District, and Verizon to call upon some of those promises with our license agreements that go back to that time period. So just putting that on the table, if there's a way where we can have full access to Wi-Fi throughout our city.
Mayor, if I can, sorry to interrupt, but it's not only Verizon. I met with a group last year. We were looking at putting a cell phone tower on our roof and providing Wi-Fi internet service for all of the Repco properties, the East End properties, at a very discounted rate, like $10 per household. I have to go back and look at my notes. It turned out that they weren't ready to do it yet in the city of Newburgh, but maybe I'll go back and, you know, call them and see if it's possible, because that's, you know, that's pretty cheap. And
so
I can't remember. I have to look for the file, so...
So if I can add, first of all,
let me ask a question,
Jonathan.
Sorry, Anthony, I didn't know you were.
That's okay. So for full disclosure, I do work for the school district. And so when I think about online technology for the program that I run, the after school program, I did want to have that application online. So that's one of those considerations when I'm looking at parents, you know, will they be able to fill this out? So of course we have to provide the paper application. Also, there is a grant that I applied for about 2 years ago and was not awarded that, but that grant is out again. It's called the Million Project.
Yeah,
it's by
I'm
Sprint.
Looking it up right now by Sprint.
Right, and so we are going to aggressively apply for that. We're going to use my brother's keepers scholars to help us apply for that, and hopefully we'll get awarded that, and that will be a step. But I agree with Mayor Harvey that we need to partner on this, form a committee, and really aggressively move this forward.
Yeah, and all the telecommunication corporations, I think if we, in a collaborative way, you know, have this these desires or these asks known, I think they'll pretty aggressively and support, you know, figure out a solution where we can get those things that we're asking for, you know, whether either at a very, very discounted rate for our residents and students, or hopefully at no charge. But, you know, so I think if we make it known, we come together collaboratively between the city government and the school district, I'm sure the corporate telecommunication companies will be willing.
And there's another thing that we can do as well is talk to Kevin White, the Performing Arts Academy. He's going to be occupying the Key Bank building right down here, and I'm sure he could probably I'm sure he'll have Wi-Fi. Maybe we could make a room in the Key Bank building available for the youth in the city. He's always writing grants and things. I mean, he's everywhere.
So the grant that Mr. Grice was referring to, it's 1millionproject.org. So potential is everywhere, opportunity is not, and that's why we're here tonight. So again, I just want to say thank you. I know you have a busy schedule. We appreciate you taking some time to.
Is there anything part of this to help train the parents? Because first of all, most parents aren't up to date with their kids' technology skills.
Right.
But a lot of places, you're going to really need that. Mm-hmm. Is there anything part of that?
So we're looking at some of our parent academies. What happens is there's a lot of need on a lot of initiatives, and part of our work sometimes that's really difficult is trying to figure out how to prioritize and address all the need that there is. But to your point, it's certainly something we can consider.
Well, I mean, obviously, if you get the parents more involved, the kids do better. I mean, that's
yeah.
And
I'll think circulate,
the kids are
going to
let their parents touch their iPad.
And Dr. Padilla, before you head out, there was, you know, several sort of studies overall that have been done in the last couple of years. I'll circulate the most recent one, which was one called Connect the Dots, that sort of looked at all of the infrastructure with a specific focus on the anchors and the school district, just as a little background. But I think this is great.
Yeah, and to Councilman Jacobson's point, the long-term vision is to create a cyber hub and a cyber center where seminars can be facilitated, free seminars on technology and technology training for adults and parents. And that even goes into resume writing, you know, soft skill building, where parents can even work consistently at improving their career field or their career options. So, so let's again thank Dr. Padilla and
thank you.
John. Thank you, John.
Thank you.
For your presentation. We definitely are going to work aggressively.
And hope to come back in a couple of months and kind of share some more exciting news around our capital project.
Sure, yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good to see you. How you doing, Michael? Yes, so moved. I move to go into executive session.
And then, Mayor, as we communicated earlier, Mr. Charles Duffy, a financial consultant, prospective financial consultant, joined us for the introduction to the council.
First,
yes.
Can we have a second on the motion and a vote, please?
I'm sorry.
Second.
All in favor?
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
You opposed?
Yes.
Okay. Really quickly. The motion carries, I believe.
Yeah, 5-1.
I also wanted to ask the council, at the will of the council and our executive staff, to allow Jason Morris and Wayne Vandenberg to also join us in Vandenberg.
We have about 3 or 4 different items to
in executive sessions.
Yeah.
Okay, so they've been made aware?
Yes.
Okay, great. Okay.
If we could have a motion to come out of executive session.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. We again want to thank the members of our community for their patience while we are in executive session. We're going to get right started. First of all, the presentation from student from NFA North, who's a student grant finalist, is anticipated for Tuesday at our council meeting. Item number four, if there's not, first of all, are there any comments on item number three? If there are none?
No, looking forward to our students presenting.
Okay. Thank you. Mayor?
Yeah, I want to just say that, so I'm excited as well. Global to Local, which is a 501c3 non-for-profit organization created by Jackie Hesse and Christine McCartney, who are English teachers in the NFA PTEC program. I work with them every day, and they are finalists. They are one of 15 finalists in a contest sponsored by State Farms to for $100, $100,000 grant to do a community service project that's centered around healing of some sort. And if they are awarded this grant, by the way, there's a website where, you know, through the month of October, you can go and vote and support Mrs. McCartney, who's featured on the website among other educators across the country. Whoever wins, and I think there are five, they're going to be five winners out of the 15 finalists, will get the $100,000. And so these students are going to come on Tuesday to present this to the council and to the public to get support, because again, if they win the $100,000, their plan is to work with Mass Design out of Poughkeepsie to create a healing memorial in one of our city parks, and somehow tied into the remains that were found that are in a repository out in SUNY New Paltz of the African slaves who were in Newburgh and dug up. So somehow there's going to be a connection with this memorial, and I think Scenic Hudson is involved as well. So yeah, so they're going to present on Tuesday, and with the students, and we're looking forward to it.
Okay, no questions or anything further. We'll move on to item number four. That relates to a public hearing that's going to be held Tuesday, October 9th, 2018, to receive public comment regarding proposed actions relating to the CDBG grant program. This is for the Consolidated Plan for Housing and Community Development for fiscal year 2019. Mayor Harvey, I understand you've had communication with Senator Schumer's office regarding some good news.
Yes, so I got a phone call from Senator Schumer's office, as well as Congressman Sean Patrick Maloney's office, saying that City of Newburgh is being awarded up to $840,000 through HUD for the CDBG program, and there may be some other awards that are also going to come from the federal government to the City of Newburgh, but definitely $840,000 for the CDBG grant for the 2019 fiscal year. And we are very excited because this is, again, an honor and privilege to be recipients of this grant funding so that we can continue with some of the great work we're doing in the City of Newburgh, especially revitalizing and providing for our community safe and equitable housing. So we're looking forward to it.
Mayor, is this an increase? Do you know?
I believe it's about the same as what we are normally awarded every year.
I think last year we originally set up a budget for about 740, is my recollection, but then we learned that we were approved for additional amount that was closer to that 800 amount, so this might either be the same or maybe a little bit more.
A little bit more. Okay. Thank you.
So whenever I'm hearing about funding from sources related to the federal government, I am smarting from still the one grant we weren't able to certify in the police department. Did they indicate anything with regard to or linkage with certifications for communities such as ours that are welcoming?
No. They didn't allude to any of that.
Okay.
They said that, you know, congratulations, that in the, they were sending out a press release this afternoon, and possibly and or in the morning, but they wanted to make me aware and the council and the executive staff aware that this grant funding was approved already, and to congratulate us and to give us a heads up before the press knew. So.
Okay, good. There's nothing further on item four. We'll move on to five. And that's we are scheduled for a public hearing Tuesday to hear the community's comments regarding a local law authorizing a property tax levy in excess of the limit established under General Muni Law Section 3C. What I want to say is that I hope to add some form to that conversation by Tuesday as it relates to the quantity of dollars that we are seeking to raise. I do not have those numbers available, and I appreciate the City Council's patience in us working out that figure. It is going to be consistent with the City Manager's proposed budget, and also I want to make certain that it also comes with the proviso that the City Council's budget may differ from the proposed manager's budget, and depending on that proposal, that number may change. So I want at least, I don't know, Michelle, how many public hearings we're going to be required to have, but I want to at least be able to present that as a number and an estimate based on the City Manager's proposed, rather than something that's going to be locked solid until we hear more from the council.
No, there's, previously mentioned the mechanism by which the property tax cap levy can, you have to pass a local law in order to have the option of doing it. It's not a requirement, but if you don't have it in place, you can't use that tool. So all local laws have to have a singular public hearing. So there is a public hearing related to the adoption of this local law. Whether you choose to adopt it or not, we just want you to have the tool in place. Separate and apart from the local law, there is a requirement in the charter that you have a public hearing on the budget itself, and there's a resolution later on in the agenda to schedule that public hearing, and that has to be scheduled in accordance with the charter. So that's the difference between the public hearings.
Thank you.
Thank you. If there's nothing further, we'll move on to item six, which is the manager's proposed budget. As I had mentioned earlier, even taking a most conservative view of the proposed budget for next year, there's no doubt in order to meet the funding requirements for the SAFER grant, as well as to account for increases in health care and a number of other items, which I hope to have itemized for Tuesday night's meeting. I anticipate that there will be a tax increase and that the tax increase will have to exceed the tax cap. This is, of course, my proposal. And in making this proposal, I am, again, emphasizing that I am taking the most conservative approach to this budget, and we're still looking at a tax increase. I will be eager to hear from the council once those numbers are specific and what your thoughts are. The administration, I say this every year, and I want to repeat it, this is the quintessential legislative function. And at the end of the day, whatever budget you provide with the city of Newburgh, we will live within those means going forward. So there'll be a lot of midnight oil being burned over the weekend, and we are confident that we will be meeting our deadline under the charter for Tuesday night.
What do you plan to be presenting? Are you going to give a synopsis of your budget Tuesday night?
It'll actually be the formal city manager's proposed budget. It's actually going to have as many.
It's not your normal budget presentation, but it's, right, or is it?
It'll be a synopsis. I'll also try to highlight the salient points of the proposal, and we'll certainly entertain preliminary questions. We would also expect, as has been the past practice, the council will want to have time to review the budget, confer with myself and staff from the comptroller's office, and any set of questions that are developed out of that review, we would hit the ground running with preparations for the first budget discussions with council. We're also hoping that...
Are you going to present it before the public hearing on the tax levy?
Well, it's only that I put that public hearing on for the work session because of the SAFER grant. I wanted to be able to emphasize the need to increase fees just for the SAFER grant. But as Michelle indicated, there's going to be a separate legislation for the budget, depending on what the council's final view is on matters relating to revenue and expenditures, so, that will be separate and apart from that, if I've characterized that accurately.
So what I would say is the council meeting is going to follow a particular order of business. Public hearings have a particular place in the agenda. Presentations typically have been at the very top of the meeting. So if it's your preference to have the budget presentation at the top of the meeting, that certainly can be accommodated. At other times, other city managers have waited to the very end of the agenda to present the budget. But the public hearings usually follow, the public hearings usually come right before general comments from the public in the order of business.
The only reason I'm suggesting that, if you're going to present a budget, and then if you present the budget after the public comments on whether to increase the tax levy, it seems to be out of order. I think the public, at least while they haven't studied the budget, would be able to make more intelligent comments if they at least heard what the synopsis of the budget is.
So then is it the consensus of council that the budget presentation be with the other presentations that would happen after roll call and after approval of the minutes? There's usually, in the order of business of the council meeting, that's usually when the presentations take place, and then public hearings, and then public comment.
Yeah, because that's probably the most important thing that's going to go happen on that, you know, so I'm just saying.
Right. I would agree with Councilman Jacobson, as it would help our public be more informed as they
make these.
Then we'll move it to the beginning. Next up, if there's nothing further on item 6, we'll move on to item 7, and that relates to a presentation from Quest Environmental. As you know, we've retained Quest as an industrial hygienist to perform evaluations on both of our safety buildings. I have asked the representatives from Quest to attend this evening. I am mindful of time, but I also believe that the information they have to share with us is important and that all of council needs to hear from it. So, gentlemen, if you wouldn't mind... You can have a seat over there. It'll actually pick up easier on our microphones and our cameras.
A lot of keys.
I know you introduced yourself last time, sir. If you could reintroduce yourself.
Yeah, good evening. I'm Ken Eck. I'm the Director of Environmental Health Safety and Industrial Hygiene and Quality Environmental Solutions and Technologies out of Wappingers Falls. I'll address the beginning of this, and then Rudy may have a few things to add. We've done assessments at both Engine 3's house and the main house and police station at $22,000. We just received the final swab samples about 2 hours ago. In summary, if you were to look at the air sampling data, it would look fine. If you look at the swab data, it's pretty much every surface we swabbed was contaminated with mold. We identified a number of species, some of which, a lot of the mold is impacting your HVAC system. We found growth on coils. We found growth on the insulation, on supply registers, return registers, clothing. We sampled the hat. It's primarily the main molds are Cladosporium and what are called Aspergillus penicillium-like, which we cultured out to identify, and it was penicillium rather than Aspergillus, which is at least good. We also identified Eurotium and Stachybotrys and Rhodoterula and possibly some Scapulariopsis.
Can I stop you for a second? Because those are all SAT words. And
yes. Way above our pay grade.
So they are, some of them are building-related molds that are because of the conditions in the building. Cladosporium is one of them. Cladosporium is a common mold. It's ubiquitous in the environment. The main issue with that is Cladosporium likes to populate or grow in droplets of water, which would indicate that you're probably getting a lot of condensation and high relative humidity in the building, which we also verified during the sampling periods. We took relative humidities. At that time, we were seeing relative humidity in 22 Grand Street ranging from 75% to 90%. EPA recommends no building humidities for extended periods of time over 60%. The Aspen, Penicillium, again, very common mold. The Stachybotrys is a building effect, one that is common in wet buildings because it is a what we call a tertiary colonizer. It comes in after there's been a period of time with sustained water, and that is, you know, that's why we consider it a building mold, because in the environment we would normally see it at least in air samples in like 1 out of 80, 1 out of 100. We took 7 or 8 swabs, we found it on the swabs, we were able to culture it. We had spore concentrations or growth concentrations in excess of 2 million spores per square inch. We did identify live growth on the coils of the HVAC system. And as I said, the supply and return registers, clothing. Up at engine 3, we duplicated the same sampling that the fire department's consultant had, and we identified very similar molds. Again, we found Stachybotrys up there on the floor of the bathroom and on the wall of the bathroom. We didn't detect any upstairs. And as far as the other parameters, which were volatile organics, the VOC levels were not particularly impressive. They were between 1 and 2 parts per million. They were all below the OSHA levels. But detecting a couple of parts per million of VOCs in the ambient air in an office is something we would at least make recommendations on how to control them better and how to reduce the potential for impacting your indoor air. We also did identify that at engine 3, all of the plaster in the building is positive for asbestos. And we have 3 areas of disturbance up at engine 3. That's where Rudy's going to be working on his part.
So let me ask you really quickly. You know, just in your presentation, I can just imagine, you know, your guys going in with white suits and white gloves and basically going like this, you know. Just to kind of give the council an opportunity to get our heads around this, in a post-industrial society, what's the probability of you guys going into any building that was erected or built for a fire station or a public safety station and not finding anything? What's that probability?
Well, it's kind of a biased probability because we only get called when there's problems. So almost every building we go into, we're looking for problems. So, in a general building that's, you know, operating properly and maintained and everything else, yeah, we might find a stained ceiling tile. We would probably find what we describe as maintenance level, you know, mold. You might have some behind a cove base molding because of what we call mop slop, the extra water from mopping a floor. If you have a sink, you can always have a vanity underneath that's going to grow mold. But to see the kind of things I'm seeing in the air handling system would be unusual at best.
So if it was a scale of 1 to 100, 100 being the worst, and, you know, zero
somewhere in the 90s.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Stachybotrys is what everybody affectionately calls toxic black mold. Even though that's a misnomer, that is what it, you know, even the CDC acknowledges that that's the wording that everybody uses when they talk about Stachybotrys. Stachybotrys on a swab sample is not unusual to find, even in high concentrations. That's why the air samples kind of look a little weird, because if you look, as I said, if you look strictly at the air sampling data, it would look fine. But Stachybotrys spores don't get caught on air samples because they're extremely large spores, very wet, very sticky. So the other problem is air sampling is only done in a 5-minute sample. So you're only looking at a few moments out of the day. But yeah, the building is got a lot of problems. I mean, you've got water leaks. You've got structural supports in the locker room. The part of the HVAC system, I don't even believe is functional. And what is functional is...
So with these environmental contaminants, if you were a guessing man, how long do you think that these contaminants existed in this site or these sites that you've tested?
Well, we came here the first time, I believe, in 2012 or 2015, and we were addressing the locker room at that point. We've been back a couple of times addressing, you know, again, different areas within the building. But, you know, I have records going back 6 years to impacts in the police station.
Are there functioning dehumidifiers?
They've brought them in now, and they have air scrubbers.
But there never was before?
No.
So, makes no sense to me.
Right, so I want to repeat what I said at the first time. We should have remediated this situation back then, but we didn't. So now were you able to put together a plan for remediation now, considering these findings?
No, we haven't been able to develop a complete remediation plan. As I said, we just got the last of the data a couple hours ago. So now that'll be our next plan, is to develop a remediation plan. But we're going to have to work closely with everybody, because you're going to have to make some critical decisions on how to handle the air handling system. How are we going to evacuate or isolate portions of the building to do remediation? Because, you know, we're talking about having to possibly replace your entire HVAC system, or at least strip all of the insulation off the inside of it. So you may have a non-functioning HVAC system in that building. You're probably going to need to replace all the ceiling tiles. Localized areas of growth are relatively, you know, are small that we've seen so far. Those will have to be taken care of, and then you're probably talking about having to clean all of the buildings in a post-remediation cleaning manner, which is detailed cleaning, because you need to reduce the amount of spores that are in the building, because that's your potential seeds if you get more water in the building. And you're going to have to also get all the water leaks and infiltrations under control.
And I'm listening to you, and as I'm listening to you, my...
cash register.
The cash register is ringing.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, we did... I checked with one of my companies that we work with. They did one of the school district remediations that have been in the papers so recently, and I believe that job was almost $400,000, and that didn't involve an HVAC system. That was just surface growth on contents within the building. So yes, you're probably looking at some sort of significant number. I would imagine the city manager or Jason might, or somebody might have a better idea of what the HVAC system would cost.
What I can say is that in our preliminary discussions, we were talking conservatively about $500,000. And that was when I had directed both the police and fire chief to develop contingency planning for alternative housing and office space. The concern that I have is that in addition to the environmental hazards, which I think are very real, we also have structural issues with that building that strongly suggest it's way beyond its useful life. And the cliche about throwing good money after bad is really heightened when we consider just how much remediation would have to be done in addition to rehabbing the HVAC system and other related matters. So I would just say very quickly, the possible, not bright spot, but a spot for our next action steps. Fortunately for us, the police department dispatch center is on a separate HVAC system with the servers that run all of the IT for the city of Newburgh. The concern that both Chief Ehlers and Chief Solomon shared with me is that and Nick Crispino, the head of our IT department, is that out of all of the things that are very complicated, admittedly very complicated, about even a temporary move out of the building, it is the dispatch centers that create the greatest challenge. So in addition to being able to optimize those HVAC systems for IT and the police dispatch, we would need to do some separate emergency configurations to provide fresh, breathable air for the fire dispatch center. And that's not to by any means diminish the other contingency planning, which we would need to talk about housing, for the police and possibly the fire as well during a clean-out if we decided to stay in that building. And if not, then housing on a more midterm to longer-term basis for the firefighters, while possibly also if we get a nod from our industrial hygienist that we could still hopefully house our firefighting apparatus in the garage. Possibly we're looking, and these are all just ideas that we want to share with you our planning, because this is happening in real time, potentially housing trailers outside the fire station. When we developed this conversation internally, it was Mr. Hogan that suggested, why don't we just triage this and start first with the dehumidifiers and the air scrubbers. It's a good suggestion, and we've acted upon it. But as I'm interpreting this, there is still a very serious concern about us either occupying the building or needing to evacuate it temporarily to clean it, or the possible need, if we're going to maximize our dollars, to come up with some alternative plans that are not permanent, but in a fair representation of the community, we're looking at more of longer-term planning simply because of the lack of capital dollars to go forward. So we're going to develop this plan. We're going to try and get together whatever bid requirements might be necessary, and we especially have to review this report with our corporate counsel and our labor counsel, because even in those instances where we have recommendations about how we might still be able to stay there, we also need to ensure the safety of all of our teams. And there's both the police and fire on a regular basis incur hazard in order to do their jobs. And I don't want this to be another instance where they're willing to endure a hazard for the greater public good, and we are, as the leaders of this community, are not looking out for their best interests. So I want us to be able to also evaluate a little more with your data, your testing data, and consult with Ms. Kelson and Mr. Zuckerman about what is also a prudent course from a public safety and public employees' safety standpoint.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll be glad to, you know, do what we have to do to meet with you, to work to try and resolve the problem, come up with some sort of game plan or number of game plans that you can look at and possibly put some numbers on to, and then see which way you want to go. Because there are various options, you know. It's just going to be the impact to the building.
Are there any other questions or comments, either from council or members of the administrative team? If not, I want to thank you for taking the time to come out this evening, and we look forward to receiving the written report. We will, of course, share it with the City Council, our fire and police chief, as well as President Hogan and the union leadership of the police department as well.
Thank you, and I appreciate the time to be here before the council, so thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wouldn't it make sense for this gentleman, are we going to do 9 and 10?
You got to talk into the microphone.
Well, he's also 9 and 10.
No, Jason's presenting 9
Jason
and 10.
Is.
Jason's 9 and 10?
Yeah. They're going to stick around in case there's questions related to it that Jason can't answer.
That's good.
If it pleases the council, we'll go to item 8. Okay. The next up is an MOU with Kuwait Sheikh Constructors for transport of steel pipeliners for the Delaware Aqueduct Project.
Good evening. This is a memorandum of understanding for, as the city manager mentioned, the transport of the steel pipeliners located currently down at the Steelways site. There's
big ones?
Yeah, the 40-foot long, 16-foot diameter steel pipeliners. So to give you the history on this project, as you know, the New York City DEP is doing a very large construction project on the Delaware Aqueduct located to the north of the city on 9W. That project involves creating a new tunnel under the Hudson River to carry Delaware Aqueduct water from the west side to the east side. The reason for that tunnel is because the original tunnel was constructed through fault lines in the rock, which have compromised the tunnel and created leaks. So that work is ongoing, and one of the later portions of that project is to line that new tunnel that they're digging now under the Hudson River with these steel pipeliners located down at Steelways. Kiewit Shea is the contractor that was hired by New York City Department of Environmental Protection to get these pipeliners from their current location up to the aqueduct construction site. So this memorandum of understanding is between the city of Newburgh and Kiewit Shea for the transport of those liners from Steelways through the city to the town of Newburgh.
So so if there's construction going on to create a new tunnel for the Delaware Aqueduct, I don't understand why do we have a memorandum of understanding just because they're transporting these steel.
They're big pipes, and they're going to be coming through our roads.
They're heavy.
And they're heavy and they're big. And we need to make sure that, in a worst-case scenario, that the city's protected if there's damage or some kind of accident related to that transport.
Gotcha. I can elaborate a little bit more. It's an excellent question. So the transport of these pipeliners from their current site on the west side of South Water Street on the Steelways property, kind of downhill from the Heights.
Yeah.
The transport corridor involves the pipeliners crossing east over South Water Street into the Steelways construction yard, and then north through past the rowing club, past the wastewater treatment plant. As the pipeliners pass the wastewater treatment plant, they need to go under a low-hanging influent pipe, which carries all the wastewater from the town of Newburgh and the city of Newburgh to the wastewater treatment plant.
Gotcha.
So the contractor, in order to get that done, has to mill the road down so these pipeliners can fit under that larger, under that overhead pipe. The pipeliner will then continue up through through the Con Iron site, and then we'll turn left onto Washington Street, and then north on Marine Drive up to the town line.
So I have two questions. Because as everyone knows, it's my dream that we would also hook up to that aqueduct as well. Mm-hmm. So is that a possibility with this? And my second question is, if they mill the road down, will they be repaving that road?
Right. Excellent question. So the memorandum of understanding has language in there that requires the contractor both to mill the road down, to replace and fix any damaged assets, and to repave the road when they're done. And that contractor, Kiewit Shea, has to post a bond to basically guarantee the performance of that work. I have Jake Badeski here in the back from Kiewit Shea, if you have any questions directly for him. And regarding the question on the Delaware Aqueduct, that's not within the purview of Kiewit Shea. They're a contractor working for DEP, but we definitely want to pursue that future connection and those conversations with DEP.
Jason, when is this going to start?
The contractor's proposing to start the first transport of the pipes. I think you're going to do a test in November of this year, right, Jake?
Yeah, there are going to be approximately four.
Can you come up and talk into the mic? That way we have the...
And does that mean you have to close off the road?
So in this MOU, it specifically states the hours of operation for the transport. All transport of the pipes have to be conducted at night, during the weekdays between the hours of 11 and 6 a.m., I believe.
At night? Is that going to create noise?
I don't think you can elaborate on that.
Well, it's pretty quiet. There's only going to be two to four shipments a night, but we're thinking two shipments a night. It's very quiet. It's regular HS20 loadings. You're not even overloading the roads. We are, and it says so in the memorandum of understanding, we'll do anything and everything in our power not to have any noise problems with the community. That's why we're doing it at night, to have less interference. We're starting on anywhere from Sunday to Thursday at 11 p.m., and then we'll be off the roadways by 7 a.m., and because of Marine Drive and the business down there, that if we have to do it on a Friday night or Saturday night, we will not start until 1 a.m. and we'll be off at 6 a.m. Oh, I'm sorry, it's the other way around. Oh, 11 a.m. to 6 a.m. Monday to Thursday, and then 1 a.m. to 7 a.m. on a Friday or Saturday, so that any business that's going on in Marine Drive with the restaurants on the waterfront would would have subsided somewhat by the time we come through. And it, and I said, it's probably going to be just two shipments a night. Mm-hmm.
And again, no noise, because I can, I live on the bluff and I can hear the noise from the shipyard. They're working on barges.
Yeah, but again, what we're doing is really just hauling the piece. It's not going to make any more noise than any other larger vehicle going by. It's just a big tractor pulling a heavy load. Okay.
So also in this MOU, there's provisions for the contractor to pay the city for any police traffic control that's necessary during the transport, and we're requiring that someone from either engineering, DPW, or water be present during the transport of each pipe for the entire duration, so that if any of the city's infrastructure is damaged, we can be aware of it as it happens. And again, the contractor has to pay for the overtime for that person to be on site during the entire transport.
And for the privilege of using the roads, there's a one-time fee of $75,000 that'll be payable to the city.
And they have sufficient insurance.
Yes, the insurance certificate's attached to the agreement.
And it's in here at the bottom of page 3 about fixing the roads should there be damage.
Yes.
It's in here.
Hey, Jason, in that area where they'll be driving, in terms of the city infrastructure, we haven't had any breaking.
It's an excellent question. We're requiring the contractor to TV those areas in the combined sewer to ensure that there's no deficiencies, both pre and post. Yeah, and should there be a deficiency, the contractor either has to fix it, provide temporary support, or provide a letter from a New York State engineer certifying that can handle adequately handle the loads of the transport.
And with the distribution of the loads, it's no more than HS20 loading, which would, all those roads should be designed for anyway.
Should.
That's why we're doing the investigation, too.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
If they're not, although they should be, but if they're not, how would that be managed in terms of any damage that might occur?
Well, Jason, I just addressed that, I believe, when he said that if we do the CCTV examinations and we find that there are problems, that they will be addressed from an engineering standpoint, that they will either be spanned over and supported not to make any issue worse than it exists, it will be fixed, or it will be analyzed by a licensed professional engineer in the state of New York that says it's okay to travel over.
For the council, can you describe the actual trailer itself? And you mentioned load displacement. Is it your standard wheels on the back, or are there extra ones to try and?
Well, the pipe sections are 16 feet in diameter, 40 feet long, weigh 80,000 pounds each. But with the, I think everybody here is familiar with a typical low boy scenario where you have a 40-foot trailer that comes down and it rides very low to the ground in the middle. Then it comes back up for the wheel assemblies again. This is just a larger version of that with many more wheels underneath it to distribute the load so that it's not any greater than an HS20 loading.
What is that, for my own edification, what does HS20 stand for?
It's standard technology, terminology in the industry for loading on highways.
Okay. It's an acronym?
Yeah, it describes the weight and axle configuration of a standard truck for the purpose of road design.
Okay.
So
thank you.
Just one more quick follow-up question. Once this road is milled, we'll be able to move other large equipment under?
No. When they pave the road, it will return back to near its current elevation. So this is kind of an extraordinary transport, and there's typically no need to have the road lower in that area as to opposed to where it is now.
The load itself with the truck requires 17 feet, 9 inches of clearance. So in addition to meeting with you over the MOU, I've also been working with Central Hudson, Verizon, Spectrum, and some third-party data guys. That all the utilities, the wires that cross over the path of the transport corridor, all have to be raised, and to this date, about 90% of them have already been done. I'm also working with the New York State DOT. There are five traffic signals that also have to be raised temporarily to provide the clearance for the loads.
Okay, and my last question, this is just for the pipes for the aqueduct, correct?
Just for those steel pipe sections that are there, yes.
Okay.
It goes without saying that we're coordinating with our police and fire for these transports, so in case there's an emergency requiring the apparatus, we'll have a sense of where you're at on the road.
Oh, absolutely, and I believe that's all stated out in the MOU.
There's a one-week lead time requirement for the contractor to notify the city's police for any assistance that may be needed during the transport. And they also, in the MOU, the contractor is required to submit pre- and post-video or photographic inspections of the transport corridor so that we have documentation if something is damaged.
Okay. Thank you. There's any further questions or comments? Having none, sir, thank you for attending tonight.
Thank you all. Thank you, Council.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So, Jason, if you take us with item 9.
Item 9 is an amendment to the previous proposal with Quest for testing at the Public Safety Building and West End Firehouse. We needed to do an amendment because of additional asbestos samples that were needed to be taken during the previous inspection. So that work was already done, and this is a cleanup proposal to amend the original. That additional sampling. Item number, any questions on that one? Sorry.
Number 10, please.
Item number 10 is a new proposal with Quest to prepare a New York State Department of Labor variance plans and specifications and air monitoring for the asbestos abatement work that is required to reoccupy the West End Firehouse, Engine 3, due to the impacted areas containing asbestos materials that were found during the previous inspection.
If there's no further questions on item 10, thank you.
What does this have to do with the high estimate that the gentleman from Quest gave us to remediate the firehouse? What's this $10,000 do? It doesn't solve anything, right?
This doesn't solve anything. This proposal is specifically for the West End Firehouse. And it is for so anytime you touch asbestos-containing materials, you have to file for a New York State Department of Labor variance. We can't meet some of the thresholds that are required in that building. And then it is to prepare the plans and specifications, which we need to go out to bid for the actual remediation of those areas to make that building safe again. It doesn't get us
it's a step in the final product. It's the step in the procurement process.
Right. We need to go out to bid for these services after the plans, specifications, and the Department of Labor variance is obtained.
Okay, nothing further. Thank you, Jason. Michelle, you want to take us on item 11, please?
Okay, so as previously discussed, the charter requires the city manager to present his budget on the first council meeting in October. That will be Tuesday, October 9th. The charter further requires that the first Monday meeting of the council in November, that there be a public hearing on the budget. Public hearing notice has to be published twice as opposed to once for other public hearings. So we have you schedule this public hearing two meetings in advance instead of one meeting in advance. So this is a resolution to schedule the annual public hearing on the annual budget. The hearing itself will take place on November 13th. November 12th is that first Monday, but that would be the observed day for Veterans Day because the federal holiday falls on the Sunday, so the convention is to observe it the following Monday. Therefore, the council meeting that week will be on Tuesday, November 13th.
Any questions or comments? We'll move on to item 12. Michelle?
Previously, at the September 6th and 10th meeting cycle, the land bank had made a request to purchase from the city several parcels of property. We had divided the transfer into two resolutions because some of the properties were acquired by the city through tax foreclosure, and two of the properties were acquired by the city through other legal proceedings and therefore required a supermajority vote to approve. At the September 10th meeting, the resolution for the two properties that required the supermajority vote was tabled. Through a series of omissions, it did not reappear on the September 24th agenda, which it should have, and so I apologize for that oversight. So now we're bringing a new resolution to you to approve the sale of those two properties. They're 44 South Miller Street and 197 First Street. One of them was acquired by reverter action, and the other was acquired by an abandoned property proceeding. So this will need 6 votes to pass.
Questions or comments? We'll move on to the release of covenants for 5758 Williamsburg.
So this request was brought to you at a previous work session. It was brought at the September 6th work session. The property has been inspected by the building inspector, code enforcement officers, and has satisfied all the preconditions for release of covenants. There are no open code violations, there are no open permits, there's a valid certificate of occupancy, and there is a valid rental license. Photos were included at that time. The council had made some inquiries about the roof. We had asked for additional inspections to take place. There's no real plausible way for our building inspector to get up on the roof, but we've included some additional photographs for you in your packets. And our recommendation as staff still remains that the property is now in full satisfaction of the deed covenants, and we are recommending that you adopt the resolution authorizing release at Tuesday night's council meeting.
No questions or comments. We'll move on to item 14.
Chief Horton, really quickly, you're satisfied with for this report? Thank you.
And so I get the satisfaction in terms of the current status of the building. Mr. Caravino, is there anything else in terms of, because this was one of those hot properties, right, that was brought up by one of the tenants who had to move out, put stuff in storage? Is there anything from that angle in terms of updates?
I don't believe so. I know that we updated council with regard to the complaint that was made, the investigation that was conducted. And Councilman Mejia, my mind might be slipping, but was there something from our building department that the council was requesting? Or?
No. My question was around the tenant aspect of it. I understand the chief already did his inspections with the caveat that, there's no way we can get to the roof, at least within our parameters.
So my department's designated to conduct an investigation, which we did. Mm. We discussed that report with council previously. We submitted to the city manager with recommendations of how to close out that investigation.
So was that investigation closed out?
Oh, it was. Now I understand.
Okay.
It was closed out in two ways. We sent a direct communication to the tenant or former tenant that had complained to us originally, and we also sent out a more detailed communication to the head of Community Voices Heard. In addition, I spoke with that representative on a couple of occasions explaining the process we followed and actually gave her a very detailed account of all the efforts we've made that treat that individual in a fair manner. And I've not heard anything since.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
So with that said, if there's nothing further, we'll move on then to item 14, and that relates to the purchase of 585 South Street at a private sale to Natasha Watterson in the amount of $89,900.
Any questions?
Oh, Natasha's not here.
She's not here. The others are, but she's not.
So just by brief background, this actually was one of the sales that was facilitated by our outside broker. It was originally scheduled to come on at the last work session with all the other properties that with that group of properties that the broker had facilitated. There was an error in some of the binder paperwork, and we needed to clear that up and revise that before we brought it to the council's attention. So we've now gotten the paperwork revised so that it's accurate. And again, the property, there's a photo in there. And
I know it.
The purchase price is the selling price that we're that we're receiving exceeds the assessed value of the property.
I've just been informed that while Natasha's not here, the River Realty rep is, if you want to ask questions.
Is he the purchaser?
No, he's not. He's the River Realty rep.
He's the broker's representative. River Realty.
He's our customer.
River Realty is our broker. He's the representative from our broker, Councilman.
If I need to say.
You guys have been doing a great job, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
So,
yeah, selling the properties.
It's a pleasure working with you guys.
She has a pre-approved mortgage, it says.
Yes.
Right? And she's from Brooklyn, and she's going to live in it.
Yes.
Pre-approved, so they all say that. There's yeah. nothing to do with that. Just from my experience, they...
No. I spoke with the mortgage person, so I always speak with
the mortgage
all
brokers
of
say a lot of things yes. ahead
That's
of time.
That's why we have a realty company.
And it also has the owner occupancy restriction in the terms of sale.
Great.
Mm-hmm. I'd love to see that house fixed.
Yeah, I'm very familiar with this house. It's up in the third ward, so I'm very, very happy to have another resident living in there and, you know, helping the community thrive. So great job.
Okay. Thank you.
Nothing further. We'll move on then.
I was looking for Natasha.
To item 15, and that relates to the purchase
to ask you.
Of 25 Gidney Avenue at a private sale to Wilbert Heiliman in the amount of $30,800.
Hi.
Hi.
This is Mr. Heiliman. He actually is a habitat superintendent in New York City, and so he's very familiar with the work that's required for these homes. He also had actually, on a separate note, he had expressed an interest in, and was committed to purchasing 49 Dubois, which I know I'm pronouncing wrong, Dubois, which we lost this week at some cost. So
what happened?
It had to be demolished. So it's an example of we had a buyer and lined up and.
Well, it's an example why Habitat and RUPCO and the land bank and all of them are so important, because we won't have these houses not falling into themselves if we sell them to the people that can fix them.
And
up.
People like Bud and,
that's
and
right,
our next
exactly.
and our next purpose. So we're very happy.
Yes.
I mean, I'm very happy.
I remember when that house was nice.
Wow. Anyway, you may have other.
Looks like a any other further
being
questions?
A New York State licensed architect, and this is something that I've kind of dedicated my life to.
Well, look
you
at
know,
it.
Working on buildings like this to keep them viable.
So you're going to rent this?
No.
Are you going to live in it?
Yeah.
Oh. Looks like there's mold. Did you?
There is mold.
Yeah.
It's mold and everything.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's the nature of the beast. The roof leaks, so the roof has to get replaced quickly. The building has to dry out, and then there's a certain amount of remediation that I'm going to have to do to it. It's just, it's the nature of the beast.
Yep.
This building is up this, it's... what's the location? Is it by the Head Start that's there? Or is it up a block
it's
further?
East of that, I think.
East of that. That's what I thought.
Yeah, it's right familiar. At the back end of Mount St. Mary's.
Yes. Mayor Harvey gets his hair cut over. He stepped out. So I know the area.
By the basketball
court. By the basketball
yes,
court. Yes,
right.
That's what I thought. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
If there's nothing further, we'll move on to the next agenda item. That'll be item number 16, relating to the purchase of 82 Carson Avenue, 45 Concord Street, and 49 Concord Street. Eugilio and Fred Carrillo Santiago in the amount of $19,000.
I think you've met Eulogio Santiago before. He's purchased some buildings on Hasbrook, among other places. He's renovated them beautifully. I've visited them. I've met the tenants there. The tenants left other buildings that were not habitable with very bad, I hate to say it, but not ideal landlords. And they're very happy. And he is a known entity on that Hasbrook Street. People know him. They referred tenants to them from their common churches. And he's, when I walk down the street, he's connected. And he's done a very, very nice job, as you can see from the before and after pictures of the, I think you have, you should have before and after pictures from some of the buildings he's already done. But these are the current three buildings that he's looking to renovate.
Okay, if there's no further questions, we'll, thank you, sir, Mr. Santiago. Appreciate it. We're going to move on to item 17.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
For what you're doing. Concord Street is a nice little street.
Yeah.
They used to have a homeowners association and everything and street block parties on Concord, but it's fallen to a little bit of disrepair. So I'm happy to see that you're fixing some of those houses.
I had indicated through your office before that all of you are welcome to come and look at what we did in Hasbrook.
I've seen them.
Just give us a call and you're welcome to walk through and see what we've done.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next up is item 17. Michelle, can you tell us about the satisfaction of judgment for 260 First Street, please?
So this is essentially a housekeeping matter. The city acquired this property through tax foreclosure. The tax foreclosure, in essence, would wipe out any inferior liens on the property. The city had a couple of housing code judgments against the prior owner, which are now unenforceable because of the tax foreclosure, but the buy it, we're selling it to, you've authorized the sale to a third party, and in order to get title insurance, the title company would like an actual instrument of satisfaction that they can record in the chain of title, just to make them, it's just a housekeeping item.
Questions, we'll move on to item 18, that relates to donations for the annual back to school event. Derek?
This was the second year that we conducted this event. We had a resolution for it last year, but I didn't notice that it was just for last year. So we've submitted one for this year, and Michelle said she's going to put it in, so it's a recurring thing, like the Memorial Day event and all the other ones.
So we're asking you to approve this for this past September's event. And then I've already updated the 2019 resolutions. It will include not only this event as a recurring event, but Councilwoman Rayford's proposal for the Black History Parade as an annual recurring event. So there'll be one resolution to cover all of those things.
Thank you.
Next up is item 19. As we alluded to earlier, we have some serious problems with the West End Fire Station. Chief Ehlers has been working to explore the possibility of sharing the brand new building that the Goodwill Fire District has just immediately outside of the municipal boundaries, which will enable us to better serve the west end of the community. I know that Michelle's had extensive discussions relating to the terms of the agreement, and while we're not prepared to present those terms, we just want to give you that status update. Michelle, do you have anything you want to add?
So I know that the firefighters engage in some direct discussions with the fire district itself. Those discussions were relayed to me through Chief Ehlers and through the attorney representing the Goodwill Fire District. So I drew up a draft agreement, and I've circulated it to the Goodwill Fire District attorney and to our firefighters. I've gotten some comments back. There's one more issue that the Goodwill District has raised that I need to research with our staff. And if we can address that issue, we would hope to present the agreement to you at the next work session. But we wanted to let you know that that was in progress as a temporary measure for our West End Firehouse.
Thank you.
Nothing further. We'll move on to item 20 relating to, I believe it was Councilwoman Rayford's proposal originally relating to rules and orders of procedure.
So After the August council meeting, I know that there was a request to limit the number of items for the work session agenda, and I did present a draft of how I thought that might be possible through amending the rules and order of procedure at the September 6th work session. During that work session, other council members had proposed making some other changes, and I didn't get to incorporate those changes in time for the September 20th and 24th meeting cycle, and I apologize for that, but I've done it for this meeting cycle, and so let me just run through what's in here quickly, and you'll let me know if there's some consensus on any or all of them so that we could try to move it forward. So the first rule going in order is Rule 3D, and that actually addresses limiting the maximum number of items on a work session. That relates to the limit, which would also limit any new items from being introduced at a council meeting that would exceed the limit that you put on the work session. So that's the amendment to Rule 3D. And that
comes up, though. We seem that only happens when we have the one meeting a month.
And that's exactly what I said. It's only July and August. Come on.
All right. If there's no...
it's only July and August.
Michelle, thank you for doing this because,
yes,
you know, there
you,
was... how do I put this? Yeah. Thank you.
Yes, thank
you. So if you're interested in moving it forward, great. If not, I will put it in a drawer until I next hear from you.
So for full disclosure...
which will be next week when the person who asked for this, who's not here right now, Councilwoman Rayford. Because let's all remember, this was her push, right? And then there was agreement, which is why then Michelle is bringing it back up. So,
well, no, I understand that, and I said it at the time. Why make Michelle go through all this work when it's only... the only two meetings, I went back through all the agendas, the average is 26, and that's, you're not going to get it any less than that. We really needed to see the people that came to buy the properties tonight. I wouldn't have wanted to eliminate that. And I thought she was here. She came up.
She came for the executive session, and then she left.
Oh.
There are some other amendments that Councilwoman Harvey, Mayor Harvey had also proposed. So they're in a red line format. And they're there for your consideration as well. This is, if I've mischaracterized anything or it's not what you thought, please let me know. But you can look at it at your leisure and let me know if you're interested in bringing it back for any purpose. Okay?
Thank you, Michelle.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Can we discuss on the other items?
Yeah, we can. So which one do you want to discuss?
What would you like to discuss?
No, about the having the public have to sign
these up. Are just proposals. It was something that Mayor Harvey...
Is this coming up for a vote?
Not if you don't want it to.
Well, I just want to say that I think that would be totally unworkable. The city of Newburgh has a history of allowing people to speak. You're going to have situations. I know when I was not on the council, I wasn't planning to speak on something, and then somebody says something which I felt was so outrageous or had to be answered, so then you decide to speak. So I think that it would cause more problems than it's worth, and particularly when we have a controversial matter, for us to limit the number of speakers as would be wrong, because people would feel they have the right to speak. And I think we have to remember that we're not here for the convenience of ourselves. We're here for the public. And
well, I want to say that, keep in mind, I do chair the meeting, and I think that needs to be respected. And I think that if there's an orderly way for us to hear from the public without limiting their ability to speak, I think that that's something that we need to continuously explore, because I've gotten suggestions from the Newburgh and Lara City School District School Board and the superintendent and some of his executive staff members who have made comments, and in fact, he made the comment today that our meetings go too long. And when I look at how the Newburgh and Lara City School Districts conduct their meetings, they have a process in which people sign up in advance if they're gonna have public comments on agenda or non-agenda items, and is done in a very organized, is done in a very tactful way, and it's done where they can get through their agenda in a way where it's very efficient. So it's not about limiting people's ability to speak. It's not about that at all, because that's not what my intent was, to put this proposal on the table for the council to only consider. And I'm going to be very frank about this, Mr. Jacobson. Getting out of meetings at midnight is ridiculous. You know, staying here to 12 o'clock at night when I am up at 5 a.m. and I take care of an 86-year-old veteran, Korean War veteran, who is my dad, preparing his meals in the morning before I go to work to my full-time job, is the reason why I have a head cold right now.
Okay.
Let me finish, Councilman Grice, because this is a sensitive matter for me.
Well, I guess we agree to disagree.
And what I'm saying is that, you know, we all work hard, and all I'm asking is the council to consider on what ways we can be more efficient with our council meetings so that we are not here till 11 and 12 o'clock at night. And we've already cut back on council members' comments, 3 minutes, we're timed, and so on and so forth. So we just need to explore that. How can we be more efficient? And I even recommended that if we're going to be conveying land, you know, instead of having them all, you know, being discussed and everything at the council meeting, we can discuss the conveyance of those properties in the work session. Then when we get to the council meeting, you could bundle those so that they're not spread out in agenda items.
Yeah. Can we also limit the presentations, maybe 2 presentations per council meeting, and also make sure that they understand they have 10 minutes at the most to present whatever it is they're talking about?
So
sometimes they go on for over 25 to 30 minutes, and that's ridiculous.
I think, I just want to point out that, again, one of the possibilities that I've put in here for your consideration is amending Rule 10, which would, again, maximum of 20 work session agenda items. If you're not interested in that, that's fine. But limiting presentations to 15 minutes, if you want to put a limit on the number per council meeting, I can add that in. Again, I'm just trying to address.
I think right. 2 per council meeting is sufficient.
So
what's 2 per council meeting?
Presentations.
So I'm probably one of the biggest violators, as Mrs. Kelson can tell you, about agenda items. Mm-hmm. I have a big agenda. And a presentation, so I have been trying to minimize that. But to Mayor Harvey's point, I also work for the school district, and I work in central office, so I do hear those suggestions. But when I go to those meetings and other meetings, I don't feel that the public feels like they're not being included just because they had to sign their name. It works in an orderly fashion.
Well, you have to take it into consideration. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I've been to a lot of school board meetings, and it's just not the same as a city council meeting where people come and talk about city business. It's not even close to being the same. And I don't like the idea of having people sign in for the reason that Councilman Jacobson said, wait a minute, I lost my train of thought here. I'm the one that brought up in January to make it 3 minutes because I couldn't believe that people could speak for 5 minutes, because after 2 minutes, they started repeating the same thing again. So it's working better with the 3 minutes. I don't really think we should have people sign in. I think it's gonna cause more problems than it's gonna help. But I also think the council itself needs to, when I think our comments should be pretty much limited. Maybe we should have Naomi start to time when everybody chimes in on things. You have 1 minute to chime in, and then you're 3 minutes at the end. Because I think that keeps us here a lot too. Not that it's not worth hearing, but you can do a lot in your 3 minutes at the end. Write it down. So at the end of the 3 minutes, when you have your 3 minutes, you say everything you have to say and you have to comment.
It's more. And every time we go into this discussion, it gets about how can we limit what the council members have to say. And I don't agree with that. And I don't like that. I'm going to be very frank. And because council members have a lot to say, and people hold us accountable for moving and acting and speaking to issues that are very important to our constituents. It's not about limiting the time that council members have to say something. It's about how can we be more efficient with regard to public comment. Now, I've literally, and with all due respect to the council members that just got on this council, you know, some of us have been here longer than you have, and you're still learning the process, you know. And
me,
and people who are new to
been
the
to
council.
More council meetings than you have over the years. Please believe me,
Patty.
And
I'm
that's
not going. Patty, you're interrupting me, Patty. Patty, you are a new council member.
Why they take all night.
You are a new council member, and you're still learning the process from this point of view.
We know the process.
And what I'm saying to you is, what I'm saying to you all is that we need to figure out a way to be more efficient when we're hearing and listening to comments from the public. And the reason why I say that, and going back to what I said and Councilman Grice has said, and we don't have to agree on this, but having people sign up in advance for public comment, in my view, is more efficient, because then we know how many people in advance have signed up. We know how much time we need for that particular agenda item, whether it's general comments or if it's agenda item comments. And the reason why, I've literally seen the public, our constituents, come into the gallery, okay? And if it's a hot topic, we'll see like two or three people online to speak about that agenda item or whatever that hot topic is. And just as the last person is speaking, I'll see someone get up at the last second and run to the line, and then two more people. And it's like, it feels like it never will end.
That's their right to do that, Mayor.
It is their right to speak, but it can be done in a efficient, well, orderly manner.
I hear what you're saying, but I don't think we should be, if we're going to be more efficient, I think we need to start with us. I mean, I think we can say a lot in 3 minutes and get to the point. And just like Councilwoman Sophocles said, you know, after a while, we do start to repeat ourselves.
Well, we have started with us, because as Councilwoman Sophocles also said, Ramona, that we started with 5 minutes for council comments, and we're down to 3 minutes. And that was the first step toward being efficient. So now the next step is for us to explore how can we be more efficient with public comments, not to take away their freedom of speech.
Changing the rule. There's a difference.
We want to be more efficient, and it's not to limit their comments, but it has to be done in an orderly fashion so that we're not here till midnight.
Well, I'm not sure I agree. I think a lot of it is some of us who are new, you know, I think we can say a lot in 3 minutes.
Well, then again, to Councilwoman Rafer's point, then we need to limit the agenda items, Michelle, to 20. Then we need to, if we're gonna say we're just gonna continue to be willy-nilly with public comments, and we don't have people signing up, and we don't have a way to know in advance how many people are going to speak that night.
I'm trying to give a vehicle for all these potential thoughts and ideas, and I'm sitting here, I'm not hearing a consensus.
Well, at least for me, right, I really appreciate the beginnings of the conversation about how do we run more effective meetings, because I think that we can all agree on that point. You know, not just for us sitting back here, being in here until midnight, but also for staff, right, who regardless what time they leave here, they still have to be in here by 8:30 in the morning, just like how we have to be where we have to be, you know, by the time that we need to be there. So I do support the concept of how do we run more effective meetings. You know, I've been to the Board of Education meetings, and I do get turned off a bit about the pre-signing that needs to get done through the clerk's office, because there's times when I just won't be able to email the clerk to say, hey, I want to sign up for this particular for this particular point. So that's one of my concerns, but I do see how they just, they run them like this, you know, and they get through the business that they need to get through the business. And in terms of us experimenting here, you know, I'm supportive of that. However we can do that, that'd be great. Whether it be through people signing up or just limiting, you know, like 2 hours of public comments, and that's it. You know, because after 2 hours, we are saying the same thing over and over and over again. You know,
I think
it's just the nature.
I think that's a good idea, and I think that it may be worth trying. You know, if we try to get people to sign up in advance and see how it works and see how it feels, that might be a possibility. When I go to the council, when I go to the school board meetings, signing up in advance, if I know that there's an issue or an agenda item or there's a hot topic or something that I've had to address, not as an employee of the Newburgh School District, but as a parent and as a tax-paying, you know, resident that pays school taxes, I'm fully aware of those hot topics. I'm fully aware of the process well in advance, where I've signed up and I've had my time to speak and I haven't felt slighted by it. You know, so I mean, it's just like I said, it's something that I think is worth continuing to discuss. Obviously, we don't have a consensus on it, but it may be something that we can try in the near future.
I think it's gonna. If you have the sign-up rule, it can have the opposite effect, because what will happen is there will be people say, "Sign my name in because I can't get here at 7 o'clock," and so you now all of a sudden you're going to have a lot more people signed in that maybe weren't even thinking of, but then their name gets called and they're going to speak.
Potentially. So I just want to point out the way I've written the proposed amendment, and you can think about it just a little bit more. So you don't. It's not required that you email the clerk during the business day. You can sign in anytime.
No. I was
up to the commencement of the public hearing that section of the agenda. And I've also noted that if somebody does have a spur of the moment impulse to speak, as long as the public hearing that public comment section hasn't been closed out by the presiding officer, they can still sign up.
Okay, right. Wait, say that again. Say that, because I didn't comprehend it.
Okay. So there's 2 points to the proposal here that
which item is it?
Okay, so it's on page 3. It's in Rule 7B.
I don't see it.
Speakers must adhere.
Right.
To the following rules.
It's 7B?
I don't think you're looking at the rules and order procedure. I think you're looking at the local law. That's the next item on the agenda, Mayor. I'm sorry.
Okay.
There's a short memo from me, and then the rules begin on the following page. Everything should be double-sided. So if you go to page 3 of the rules,
okay,
and look at Rule 7, which is towards the bottom of the page, the suggestion in Rule 7B is that speakers have to sign in prior to the beginning of the public comment period. So they have time during the pledge, although it's a little disrespectful, but during certain pre...
So in other words, if we have all these people signing up, the mayor or who's ever running the meeting at the time can still limit and cut people.
So there's 2 things. So they can continue to sign up as long as the mayor hasn't closed that portion of the meeting. Once the mayor closes that portion of the meeting, everybody's done. And then the other item that I did put in there as a discretionary item, so it's on the next page, it's on page 4. I added a new subsection D, that before the public comment period begins, the council may limit the duration of the whole period. So if it turns out that there is a ridiculous, you know, we have a very long agenda for whatever reason, or there's a number of things, or you have to go into an executive session for whatever reason, if you could have the discretion to vote ahead of time.
So if 60 people sign up then, you're saying the council would have the discretion then to limit each speaker to 1 minute.
You could, however you wanted to set it up, but you could limit the total duration of the comment period.
The duration. So right now, just for comparison, the school board, not only do you have to sign up, but they've also truncated it to it's only 1 hour. That's it, 60 minutes, no matter how many people sign up. And they'll keep the list of names running, because to Michelle's point, people sign up, or to your point, and then they don't come.
Just food for thought. I'm not saying these are great ideas. I'm not saying they're the best ideas. I'm just trying to give words to the ideas that you've expressed for your consideration. If there's a way to improve it, I'm all for it. I just need to know how you want to proceed following tonight's meeting.
Yes.
And you know, I think that it's worth, giving it a try. You know, if we say that at the beginning of the meeting, people can register up until that public comment section, I don't think there's a need to limit it.
It's discretionary.
Right. So
if you don't, you don't.
Right. That's good. Yeah. Okay. So are we looking to employ this?
Well, so that's what I need to know. I need to know whether I should add this as a resolution for Tuesday night. If I did that, and if it were approved, it would take effect at the second council meeting in October.
Okay, so I'm going to...
That's to limit our...
Two things. Councilwoman Rayford isn't here tonight. And I need time to digest this, and I'm thinking that she would also. So do we can we put it on to the...
Digest what? I'm sorry, I couldn't hear with that.
I think Councilman Grice, and not trying to put words in his mouth, but I speak loudly. He would like some more time to consider what's the words on the page, and would like to have another work session on this. And also...
I agree with that. And is it crazy to... maybe consider having a public hearing on this?
I don't think it's necessary.
Well, can I just add one more thing? I'm a time person. I keep track of time. And even the night we had all the people at the rec with the firemen there and everybody there, our public comment session was only a little over 2 hours. We had two speakers ahead of time, the lady from the district, that was a half an hour, and we got out of there, that was the latest one. Only 2 hours that night. The other night, it was 48 minutes. I write them down.
So do I. Right.
And so Michelle, it was like 48 minutes last council.
You gotta limit these presentations.
Patty, let's start there.
The limit of the presentations is in here.
Yeah, that's in there. But I think that night we were at the work session, I think it was Michelle Kelson or someone from the executive staff pointed out to me that night that the public comment section lasted 3 hours.
Yeah, it was 3 hours.
It was 3 hours.
It was 3 hours. Yeah.
It was not 3 hours.
It was 2 hours.
And I have it written down, and she writes it down too.
Yeah,
2 hours and 40 minutes. 2 hours and 40 minutes.
It was like 2 hours and 40 minutes.
It
felt like 3 hours.
I know it did.
It was like it might have been 20 minutes shy, honestly. It was like 2 hours and 40
Counting
minutes.
Presentations, maybe.
Okay, but regardless, so now we've spent like 40 minutes on this, so I'm going to shut my mouth and...
I'm fine.
I support it. I think it gives us flexibility whether people sign up or don't sign up.
I think that...
I don't agree with it. So right now I'm hearing a 50-50 split.
50-50.
So I can put it on and you can debate it further on Tuesday night in addition to everything else, and maybe pass it, maybe table it, I don't know. Or we can talk about it at one more work session. Your pleasure?
Let's talk about it at one more work session. Let's talk about it at one more work session because, again, Councilwoman Rayford is not here. And I think, considering she brought it up, that she deserves that opportunity.
No, she brought up limiting the agenda item numbers, not this.
Okay.
But.
All right.
Roll
the dice.
Yeah, let's roll the dice.
Let's just move on before we're here till midnight.
Okay, I got it. It'll be on.
We're voting on it Monday, Tuesday?
It'll be on for a potential vote, you'll have opportunity to further debate at that time.
Okay. Anything further? We'll move on to 21. That's a local law amending section C312 relating to residency requirements.
So we talked about this amendment last year in 2017. We talked about it again over the summer in 2018. It's been adjusted a little bit. A public hearing. We held a public hearing at the last council meeting. The comments were relatively benign, and it's ready for a vote if you're ready to vote on it. And I just need to know how to proceed.
Yep.
Let's just vote.
Yep.
Okay.
Michelle?
Yes?
Just two quick questions. First of all, you're saying that it would only apply to two individuals?
No, I'm saying it would. What I'm saying is that this amendment has a proposed now effective date of, if presuming that you vote on it and it is approved Monday night, Tuesday night, October 9th, it has an effective date of October 15th. And what that would do is on, as of that effective date, city employees, all of us, not just the department heads, who are currently employed as of that date and who aspire through the ranks to a department head level, would be grandfathered the same way that the department heads were originally grandfathered.
Yep.
New appointees after the effective date, new employees to the city who later on would potentially be promoted, would be subject to the residency requirement.
Okay.
So there are some current city employees who would benefit right now immediately from this amendment. And there could potentially be, in the future, some other beneficiaries. But it would be a more equitable application than what was originally adopted in 2015. At least that's what my recommendation is.
Okay.
Thank you. Next up, Councilman Grice, discussion relating to Delano Hitch Baseball Stadium improvements.
After we get ShotSpotter.
So you're gonna have to come up. You're gonna have to limit it to 10 minutes, Mr. Stanton. Your presentation.
Oh,
or
seriously?
Actually, shorter.
Shorter than that. Yes.
I can make it very short.
Thank you.
But didn't we do? We
covered
this.
This already.
Yeah, we already talked
about
it.
Did you get this?
Yeah, it's right here. This is
Yes, I believe we've gone over it a couple of times, and again in the budget brief on Monday. Basically, we're just trying to find the money.
But I think George, you have the money, correct?
I don't have the money. The money is given to the comptroller's office. There's money that we get from the county every year to do park improvements, sidewalk improvements. It's $20,000 or $30,000. That's what you need to see if that is spent yet or not. Because I don't know if that was spent last year for the warming shelter or not.
How do I find that out?
Well, we're having the budget presentation next week, and just look at the budget line. Do you remember what the budget line item was, Mr. Garrison?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
I'll see if I can make a phone call tomorrow.
Okay.
Thank you.
And the ShotSpotter, you know me, and ShotSpotter has to be first.
And the ShotSpotter. But again, if you build it, they will come.
Yes.
Oh, you should make
they will play.
Shot.
What, Patty?
Okay, great. Next?
Next up is actually the first code compliance monthly report.
Wow.
This is intended to actually propose the first set of metrics relating to the performance in the building department.
Yes.
Thank you,
and
Chief.
What more importantly is that if there's something by way of criteria or other performance measures that the council would like to suggest. The council would like to suggest we would ask you for your indulgence and then to make suggestions. So we have both Chief Ehlers and Assistant Chief Horton that are going to discuss tonight. I believe it's Chief Horton. And I want to say that Chief Horton has done a magnificent job of resuming the leadership role under Chief Ehler's guidance of the code enforcement teams. And I just thank you, Chief Horton, for all that you've done to stabilize the code enforcement office.
So knowing that we haven't had a monthly report, I tallied the totals for the year so far for the 9 months. Starting with permits, we've issued 1,440 permits through the end of September. That's about 160 a month. We do about 80 per month of permit inspections. We've handled 2,108 violations this year for 235 a month. We've done 812 rental inspections, which typically can be anywhere from 2 to 4 units each. So it might be as many as roughly 2,400 apartments inspected in the 9 months. We've done 602 vacant building inspections, and we have 177 cases currently in court. Mayor Harvey asked where we were with the court. I was a little late in asking Mr. Kaufman about the status of court cases that have been closed. He's currently tracking that down, and we'll have it for the next time. These are the typical inspections that we're doing on a regular basis. If you look at it and break it down even farther, we're normally doing about 30 items a day in the office. On top of one thing I don't have here that's not an IPS is the title searches that we typically do, about 35 a month, which take up a lot of time as well. We did some looking at our phone banks. We have probably, except for PD dispatch, we have the busiest phones in the city. We normally answer about 80 to 100 phone calls a day. We normally have anywhere from 40 to 50 visitors to the window every day. And it's a busy office for seven people.
It is. Councilman Jacobson mentioned something in the previous session, budget session, about when there's a code violation and how we can keep accruing that for the funds on that violation.
I did speak to the assistant attorney, and we're talking about that right now as to how we can better document it and make those inspections to maintain some type of from beginning to end with no break that the court system.
So that you have the big hammer of 250 a day.
Exactly.
That type of thing.
You know, I think going down the road, there's some things we want to look at. Our permit fees are pretty light compared to some other municipalities.
I was going to ask you, how much are the permit fees that are on here on the inspection fees?
For the permits, the permits for a commercial building inspection permit, it's only $12.50 per thousand of the cost. And people are typically not very upfront about how much something costs. And we don't really have the capacity to go out and say, well, you're telling us it's $50,000, but it's really $70,000. We're not making that distinction. I can tell you, though, that a colleague of mine in Western New York, a $200,000 job in Western New York is a $6,000 permit. We charge a little over $2,000.
Wow.
We charge $25 for an electrical permit, and that could be for putting in one outlet or wiring St. Luke's Hospital.
See, that's where that's a problem, because if it's just a homeowner has a very simple job and they're going to obey the rules and get a licensed electrician as opposed to do it on the side, you don't want to make it too much for that person because it defeats the purpose of the code. On the other hand, if somebody's got a big project, it's different.
Yeah, and certain projects are very time consuming, and we might only be collecting $100 for the permit. So possibly down the road, once we stabilize a little bit better, we might want to look at our fee structure in the code as to what we do charge and make sure it's equitable for the person who's putting a small amount of work into their home or a person who's going to build a 98 unit.
And looking at fee structures for permits, I think it's a great idea, but I think that Councilman Jacobson's always talking about enforcing the code, and we got to do better at enforcing the code. I think it's important not only look at the fee structure of the permitting, but also looking at the fee structure for violations and doing an analysis of that, because and then what are the follow-ups to that. And in fact, Chief Horton, this is an excellent report, and in fact, I think that we could possibly, moving forward under the city manager's guidance, get reports like this from other departments. We've asked and requested for reports and Gantt charts and different things throughout the year, and we're still waiting on other departments and for reports, right? So how to be more efficient, looking at the numbers, being able to do a data analysis of these numbers is the only way we can figure out how we can be more efficient and be better at whatever it is that we're doing in each department, not just code enforcement. But we know that's one of the top priorities because of the conditions. Now, the other point I want to make quickly, Michelle, you and I've had conversations because Councilwoman Monteverdi and Councilman Jacobson and I went to the New York Conference of Mayors, and I think Jacobson and I sat in the seminar where we were talking about taking title of properties, and I know that that's something that you guys are doing in legal. But there may be a way where we can look at Chief Horton's reporting on code enforcement and say, oh, well, these buildings that are abandoned have been abandoned for a certain, you know, and kind
they,
of.
They, Jeremy Kaufman, who has really undertaken this initiative to make it his project, he's really taken this under, he's worked very closely with Chief Horton to, because Chief Horton has to, as the building inspector, he's got to make a preliminary finding before we could even proceed with abandoned buildings. So it absolutely, in order to do those kinds of litigation, those kinds of actions, we need to work very closely with the building department. We need to work with the building inspector. And right. I think that they're doing.
And I'll attest, the work that Jeremy does with us every day is priceless. It's
right.
In fact, the 44 South Miller that is now up for a vote, we have other cities calling us up and saying, how did you do that?
Right.
The NICOM's been talking about Article 19 of the Real Property Actions and Proceeding Law for a long time.
Right, right.
And I've been at a number of seminars where General Counsel Wade Beltramo has incorporated this into his vacant and distressed properties presentation. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and so I participated in the dialogue and, like, what are the benefits? What are the pitfalls?
Right.
Why isn't it working? How isn't it working? And one of the things that's always been a little bit of an impediment from my perspective is that it's harder to extinguish other encumbrances on title through an abandoned property proceeding. Tax foreclosure is much more draconian.
Easier, yeah, yeah.
It takes a lot longer, which is the pitfall of tax foreclosure. So, yeah, Jeremy has really studied this and taken and found a couple of properties that we thought would really fit the mold, and now that we've been successful, it's going to create some synergy. So
that's great news.
That's good.
That's excellent.
I think that
news.
Was Troy, New York, where they were doing it.
Oh yes,
you went to that seminar.
Yep,
yeah.
Yep, and Troy.
The cities that have expressed interest into what Corporation Council has been working on are part of the City Rise cities that we're part of.
That's right.
The second round, you know, we won that second round as well. So some of those 10 cities that are participating partners with us are very interested in what we're doing with some of the work with that.
Yeah, exciting. Thank you.
I also just wanted to quickly add, I included to the council two handouts. The heating season's coming up. So carbon monoxide is a big problem here in the city with poor heating units. So if you can push that out to your social media friends, it'd be a big help. And the second thing is we're partnering with the Red Cross on October 27th to hand out free smoke alarms and actually install them. We're working right now to build a rally point and where we'll go out and actually install smoke detectors in people's homes if they need them. So that's a partnership with the Red Cross. And if
that's terrific. How are we gonna get people to know that?
We're working on that right now. Hoping to, we're probably going to get kids from the Mount or students from the Mount to help us with the installation. The Red Cross brings volunteers, and we'll coordinate it. And hopefully, we're looking to install a couple thousand smoke detectors.
We're going to post it on the website.
We're going to hand it out tomorrow. I just got these in the mail today. So,
and I'll post it on my social media pages tomorrow.
I don't see a location here.
We have to decide that yet. So
okay.
We're just kind of asking if you can keep it in your file, and then we'll push it out, and we'll update this one and get it out there. But I just want to let you guys know about it, and it's very important. The detectors save lives every year here.
It is, but what I get a lot of my landlord clients in the city of Newburgh say to me, they take the batteries out. So are they going to be inspected after they're given? I mean, I know that's nothing you can do about it, but that's one of the big
things. We do our absolute best. We'll get them out there. We'll do a quick education in the apartments. We just don't. No municipality has the capacity to.
No, I know.
To double check and triple check apartments.
No, we can't afford it.
It's education. It's really making everybody understand that it really is for their benefit, for their own protection, and the beeps that you hear are necessary and important to remind you to change the batteries. Don't just take them out and throw them away. I don't need this. Go through the extra steps, and that's an education and a learning curve that everybody needs to understand.
And this is this week will be Change Your Battery Week anyway for smoke detectors. We every October and change the clocks, change the batteries. So when we change our clocks, you want to change your batteries. So if you happen to have any ideas about how to amend that report, we'll do this going forward on a monthly basis and let you know where we are. Just as a quick...
Chief, is it possible to put this on a spreadsheet or...
I could, however you want to do it, just I'll take care of it. Just on a quick note, for the permits, we did 1,440 through the first 9 months. 4 years ago, we did 482 through the first 9 months. So almost 1,000 increase over 9 months in 4 years.
Wow.
That's great.
Yeah, so there's a lot of work on it.
Definitely should increase the fees, huh?
Wow. Well, we should consider it at least.
Yes, I think
yes,
so.
We should. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right.
Thanks. The last item I believe we're going to discuss tonight, and we'll resume items 25 and 26 with Council's permission when Councilwoman Rayford is here, is the capital plan review. My intention this evening is merely to represent that to the Council members that recognize it and to introduce it to those who have not. Just as an overview, without a doubt, we have a tremendous amount of capital needs for this community, particularly as it speaks to our public safety buildings, the structural integrity as well as the environmental conditions of them, the structural integrity of this building, the structural integrity and environmental conditions of the DPW building. I believe that out of all of our public facilities, the water filtration plant building is probably the very, very best building that we have. That's been identified in a capital plan that we last revised June 10th of 2015. What you'll see quickly is the triage was for us to dedicate our capital and bonding capacity to those matters that spoke to the potential for fines from the DEC. And what we want to also inform you of is that we will be reaching out to our bond council to get the latest update in terms of what our bonding capacity is at this point. I don't believe it's going to be hopeful, though, in terms of the dollars that are available. A tremendous amount of bonding capacity for the community was gobbled up with the municipal courthouse. And there are a number of other matters that we have tremendous needs for, but not the finances to do it. So as we're going through the budget season, I wanted you to at least have a chance to take a look at this. We will also be reviewing it. And in response to Councilman Jacobson's comments about whether there is any possibility that there are general fund expenditures that could be capitalized, over a longer term period, we're holding that question in mind as we review the budget. And certainly, obviously, beyond the city manager's proposed for Tuesday evening, we will expect there to be a robust dialogue about the competing priorities for our community. If there are capital dollars that we have not yet accounted for, we will find it, and we'll bring that information to the city council as part of the overall presentation of the budget. But with the gentleman speaking from Quest and a discussion about capital planning, I thought it was important for us to look at the work we've achieved thus far. And it was really intended to be comprehensive in asking the department heads, as well as the council at the time, for us to just be able to identify the known universe of capital needs that our community has. And the dollar amounts are quite sizable, while our bonding capacity is minuscule. So if there's any questions, we'll try to answer them, but we really merely intended for you to have something to go home and review, and like us, be prepared to speak in greater detail.
I just have one comment. I had mentioned this during some of the budget sessions. There were a lot of departments that had to make some important structural repairs. You know, I'm talking about roofs. You know, if a roof is going to cost $100,000, $150,000. And if that's the case, a roof is going to last what, 10 years, 15 years? What's the normal rate on that? And shouldn't, I think that we can save a lot of money in this year's budget by going through each department, see which things really should be a capital expense, and pay them over the life of the project. I mean, you would do that in your house. You don't take a 15-year loan on painting a room, but if you do a roof, you would. And I think this would make a lot of sense, and we could save a lot of money.
It's a great suggestion. We'll review our bonding capacity. If we have the capacity to capitalize costs for a roof replacement, I think that's an excellent idea.
Well, I think we should see as much as we can do to, because we shouldn't be expensing things that are really and should be in the capital budget. That's just what I think.
You're right. That's like accounting 101.
Which is why you have a capital budget.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments? No. With everyone's...
Wait. Can I just comment on 26? Because even though Councilwoman Rayford is not here, she's not going to expect a vote on this Monday then, right?
No, I've spoken to... Councilwoman Rayford asked about this a council meeting ago. I've spoken to her over the phone, and she actually came to my office during the week. And I explained to her, and I'll explain to all of you, if there are these ceremonial resolutions that you're interested in carrying, I'm happy to help you craft them, but it's hard for me to do the research that goes into them. So as long as you're willing to get the biography or the background information and provide it to me, I'm happy to write the resolution for you in advance. So what I had said to Councilwoman Rayford is that if she could get me the information, I would draft it for her. She hasn't, I understand there's been some other circumstances, she hasn't done that. So before she left tonight, I said that if she could get it to me, we would move it to the next work session.
I would actually, I've been thinking about this, and I'd like to have a public hearing on this.
You can have, I think, it's not my recommendation to have a specific issue public hearing on these types of items.
Okay.
If you're talking about streamlining your meetings and how to make them more efficient, from my experience, single issue public hearings where they're not really required do not streamline meetings. But you're free to discuss amongst yourselves whether this is an appropriate thing to do. I'm sure anybody who has a strong interest one way or the other could find a couple parts of their 3 minutes to tell you how they feel about it. But I was just giving you my how I address these requests that come in from each individual council member.
Thank you.
Also, I wanted to say, because it slipped my mind earlier, when we talk about being more efficient and time conscious during our meetings, I have been, you know, since April, visiting different boards and commissions and seeing how those meetings go. And a lot of times I've found out that, and I mentioned this before, public doesn't have a space, or it's not past practice for the public to be able to speak publicly at some of those boards and commissions that we have. Right. So that's something that...
Well, that would be up to the individual boards to make up their rules, own rules and procedures. The land use boards have public hearings when they're required by law. I can tell you that the Police Community Relations Board does have a public comment period at every meeting. So each of the individual boards, if you want to talk to their chairpersons and suggest that, that's fine. But the boards have to make their own rules of procedure.
Right. So maybe, and this goes back to some sort of quarterly reporting, or so we know what's going on with some of the boards and commissions, and even some of the departments that are in our city, you know, because, and when I talk about the boards and commissions, I get phone calls, and some of our council members get phone calls about police matters, you know, that could have gone to the Community Police Relations Board before it gets...
Well, I,
they like jump over.
Well, one, now you've given me the opportunity. The Police Community Relations Board is suffering terribly for lack of support from the City Council. I have emailed all of you. There are holdovers, there are vacancies, and there have been no replacements. I have four people who continually come and make an effort every month to do the best that they can. They very oftentimes we can't field that fifth person for a quorum, and they cannot transact business, and is incredibly frustrating. The other thing that they're incredibly disappointed about is that there is absolutely no funding in the 2019 budget for their program. They fought hard to get some funding when they were originally created, and I have some expectations that some of the members might come on Tuesday night to talk to you about it, but I have single-handedly tried to keep that board afloat. It's taken so much of my time and effort, and I am incredibly frustrated.
So what type of support is expected from the council?
Every ward member has at least one vacancy to fill, if not two. And we need people who are willing to serve, who are willing to come out on a monthly basis and participate. And that would make a tremendous difference right there, but they cannot do it if they don't have the membership that's required. Right.
So what kind of expectations is what I'm asking? What type of expectations does the Community Police Relations Board expect from the council?
To appoint people.
We need the ward members to review their vacancies and to find and to help and to appoint people who are willing to serve, and maybe there's nobody who's willing to serve. I don't know, but if that turns out to be the case, if we cannot fill the vacancies on this board, then you have to seriously consider how you're going to keep it going.
Michelle, right, I thought that there was some money in the budget. I thought I looked at the budget for education.
There was in 2018, but
not for 2019.
What was proposed in 2019 was a complete defunding of the board. So I would urge you to just double check that when we're going through.
I was here
the night that the land use boards presented. I was here for my own department, and the police board's budget was that night, and it was defunded.
Okay. So I had asked, I believe it was,
missed that.
I always ask for a lot of things, and yes. Thank you for being patient with me. But I did ask that we publicly put out for all of those committees that we're looking to fill those seats. Can we do that now?
I'm hoping that I can get some administrative help to do that.
We can do that.
For those of you who are ward representing
the website,
for those of you who are in your wards, you have independent power under the ordinance to appoint those members.
Right.
So if you have a holdover and they need to be reappointed, and they've been continuing. I'm just going to use Ward 2 as a prime example. I know I have one holdover and one current appointee. Those are two of my regulars. If the holdover is interested in a new term, please, please, please let me know.
Okay, I'll reach out to
them. But there are vacancies in Ward 1. There are there's holdovers and vacancies in Wards 3 and 4. And
vacancies for what?
The Police Community Relations.
Okay. Well, I know Satira's in my ward.
You have to look at the spreadsheet. She may be a holdover. I know.
I didn't think there was a vacancy in my ward.
Tony Bruce is a holdover for sure.
And there's two vacancies in the Ethics Board.
There's more than two vacancies. The whole Ethics Board has pretty much resigned. You need to.
Michelle, who's the holdover in my ward?
Peter Fraze. Richie was appointed before Councilwoman Abrams vacated her seat, so her term expired. So,
okay. So I've found one.
Yes.
Hold on to the holdover, but I think he probably won't.
I think it's one of those.
His term has almost expired, and
I'll get the second one.
He's not feeling well, I understand that. The person who was proposed did come to visit with another member from Ward 3.
Okay, perfect.
And I left her my card.
I talked to her.
And if she's interested, I'm happy to do an appointment letter.
Okay, perfect.
So send me your contact information, and I'm happy to facilitate that.
Okay.
And I also want to encourage some of our councilmen and women who are in wards to have a presence in your ward, because I've gotten phone calls all summer that some of you haven't even showed up in your wards.
Or what?
That you're not even present. I've gotten that criticism. And I'm not saying all, but there's a couple ward council members I've gotten.
I find that very hard to believe.
Me too, because I'm out every day.
That you've never mentioned it to me till tonight.
No, but I wasn't saying it was you, Jacobson.
Well, you said it's either me or Anthony.
No, there's four ward persons on our council. Hmm? There's four people in ward seats. And all
Where
I'm
are
saying
you talking
is,
about that we're supposed to be, besides out on the streets talking to our constituents?
Say that again?
Where are you saying that the ward people aren't if we're not? I'm out on the street every day in the fourth ward.
Yeah, no, I'm not talking about you.
Oh, okay.
I'm just saying, you know, if you're in a ward seat, just please have a presence in your ward from time to time, because I've gotten that criticism seriously all summer.
I think I got you about 100 signatures from my ward, so I think I need a big presence.
For the record, I no longer live in the city of Newburgh. I only commute for the council meeting, so that is why you haven't seen me.
No, I have something more serious.
Okay, just kidding, for the record. So,
can I just ask
something more serious than the last comment?
Just kidding, guys. Relax.
Our executive session, we talked
and
about.
And that's BS, by the way. Okay, so I'm just saying, because you know what? Like, that's just crazy that people are going to go down that path. And if they have something to say, they can come up and say it to me.
Can I just ask a question about the money? You said they have money in this year's budget. Can they encumber that over to next year?
I'm going to ask, because they had an expense that they planned to spend in September, and through no fault of their own, that was postponed into next year, and I'm hoping we might be able to. I have an invoice. I'm hoping to encumber those funds, but we'll see. That's a finance question, not for me to.
Quick question. George, we had a conference call the other day about the recycle grant that's $2 million that we're going after. So we have some questions for you.
Okay. You can talk tomorrow if you want.
Councilman Jacobson wanted to say something 3 minutes ago.
Yes, because previously, before we started this public meeting, it was brought to our attention that the city manager would like to have a consultant hired to help him through at least the next week or whenever for the budget. So don't you think we should discuss it and whether or not we're going to vote on it Tuesday night?
I think the consensus of the council is that you're prepared to approve a contract.
That's my mind frame.
Ian,
yes.
That's mine.
Have we any further thoughts? The critical work to meet the deadline, the city manager's deadline for Tuesday night.
I thought the consensus was he was going to be here tomorrow and weekend up until the budget on Tuesday.
Yeah.
So the city manager, that had help. That's what we decided.
Do we have a contract?
Yeah, it's going to be a standard vendor services agreement, which is a city. It's a standard contract that we use for a lot of outside consultants. It'll have a scope of services. It'll have a Schedule A scope of services, which is the preparation of the budget, review of the financial statements, preparation for the 2018 audit, because that'll be coming up soon, and general advice to the subordinate staff. And then there'll be a fee for the services in Schedule B. And I will have that for you on Tuesday.
Great.
Okay. Great. Thank you. So we'll continue our work.
Thank you.
Meeting adjourned.
Thank you.